Hello, my friends. I have today some very strange material to show to you. It's about Antarctica. It's about a map that is considered to be the real map about Earth. It's called Terra Infinita, and it's supposed that there are 178 worlds under a great dome. And under this great dome also exists Earth. I found this material from a YouTube channel called Nos Confunden. So I'm going to read you from a book that this guy has in English. Chapter 1, to Antarctica. My name is William Morris, and the story that you are about to read, it is probably going to modify the current way of seeing the world. I know most of people will find it incredible, and me, even having experienced this adventure, having seen it with my own eyes and with all my senses, it was also incredible to myself. But the evidence is irrefutable for those who want to see it, and the memory is indelible. Such evidence will be presented, and science will also change its perspective, and another path will be opened in the human mind forever. As for my personal life, I was a member of the Continental Navy, as the American Naval Force was called in the Revolutionary War. I was married to Lucy, and we were thinking of enlarging the family, but the war postponed every plan, as it usually does. One peaceful night, after the surrender of Saratoga, we were sailing through the northern Atlantic Ocean, rounding the islands on our way to Charleston Harbor. The full moon was the only light that illuminated our way, and during that night, thousands of stories and anecdotes arose among the boys over a little whiskey to calm the anxieties of a raw war. Even then, there was talk of James Cook's voyages and his obsession with crossing the Antarctic Circle, although it was not clear who was behind his funding or why the obsession. As I was not well steeped in the subject, the talk had not captivated me enough. I did not pay much attention, and the boys went on with the stories. Captain Butler, who was well respected in the group, joined in the sailing stories by commenting that it was possible that there was a passage somewhere in the polar circle, and that this passage could be the connector to other worlds. He said it seriously, without a moment's hesitation. My attention turned to him, and the five or six of us in that cabin were speechless, listening to his story. We expected him to say that it was a joke, but that never happened. We could not believe that the captain was seriously telling that there could be lands behind the Antarctic Circle. Butler commented that he knew from good sources at the highest levels that they were researching and funding voyages to penetrate the harsh climate and barriers in the southern latitudes to find possible land and perhaps civilization beyond the Antarctic continent, and that they were in a hurry to carry out these missions as many civilian navigators were circling the area and did not look favorably on anyone else coming along. This story was even longer and in great detail. He also commented that he observed with his own eyes a map that indicated the coordinates that could be the opening of such a passage. Time went by, and after the famous war, many of the ships used by the Continental Navy were rented, destroyed, captured, or sold. And as at that time I was a person of good economic standing, I made an offer for one of them and managed to keep it. The idea of the exploration trip to the south, after Butler's story, generated even more interest for me to beat and keep the ship, although it needed repairs. I felt no guilt, as I felt it as an investment, although I did not know the real danger of such a trip. I needed to provide myself with a great navigation equipment. During the idea of forming the team, I talked to former colleagues. Some of them made the most ridiculous excuses, and I don't blame them either. The idea of such a trip was really not encouraging. Two of them, who were there that same night that Butler told his story, wanted to join as soon as I told them about the plan. But the most difficult part was to convince Butler. who had knowledge in navigation based on his experience and leadership, and also knew the coordinates where we should go. After gathering courage for a few weeks, I contacted the captain to tell him about my project and add him to the group. It was difficult to convince the captain of such a plan, and although in his voice I noticed some enthusiasm, he declined my offer, and it was like that for a while. Unexpectedly, on the morning of October 11th, he showed up at my home with another companion named Fint. He had maps that I had never seen, and was full of documents that very few eyes had read. He told me that he accepted the deal, but it could be only a one-way trip. Then I understood that we had to take this trip professionally. The adventure was about to begin. Chapter 2. The Custodians. After such a phrase from the captain, we finalized details and agreed on a departure date. It would be November 14th. His mysterious partner, Fint, as he introduced himself, would also join the team. My boat would be ready even a month before. On November 12th, just 2 days before leaving, Fint, Battle's partner, showed up at my door with another man who looked even more mysterious than him, all dressed in black and with a strange accent. He told me it was urgent and I made them enter my home. Fint had a briefcase, which he opened as soon as he entered on top of a table. Inside there were many documents, and among them he took out a kind of ancient manuscript and began to recite a part of it. Then, by demand, I subscribe in major importance here by desire of our lords that the doors of knowledge be closed to those who refuse to be part of our glorious path and liberties granted. The text went on for several more lines, and then at the end the so-called poem Regius was recited. As soon as he finished his reading, I commented that it seemed that he was in some kind of initiation rite. It was then when Fint commented, "Exactly, comrade. Precisely those who did not pass this initiation are the marginalized. Better said, we are the marginalized." I demanded, "Fint, please explain a little. I am not understanding anything. What does this text mean, and what does it have to do with our trip?" "I'm going to explain a little of the situation. This manuscript belongs to the custodians, as we call them, or as they call themselves, the sun gods. And they found out about your trip through Butler. The high spheres are aware of it, and it does not make them happy. This manuscript raises that they will not let anyone leave these lands by demand of the lords." The situation could not get any worse. An adventure that was already risky enough due to the harsh weather and everything that could happen to us due to natural events, now we were adding these unknown enemies. "Who are these custodians?" I asked. Fint went around in circles, and his strange friend opened his mouth for the first time, interrupting, and he commented that these custodians were not happy about our trip, and that this was the only thing they could tell me. Fint then suggested that we should cancel it, that it wasn't worth risking our lives. He said it with a threatening tone. That's when I then invited them to leave my house immediately. His strange friend looked at me defiantly and they left. After a few minutes, I tried to communicate with Butler, to ask him what was happening, and to make him comment on the situation of this strange visit. Butler never answered, neither that day nor the following ones. I gathered the emergency team to analyze how to continue this travel plan, which was becoming dark and sinister, but an inner force pushed me to continue. The passage to other lands was becoming even more real, but also more dangerous. We met with the whole team. Butler was not there. Nobody knew about him for weeks. He was missing. I told them the whole sequence about the visit of Fint and his partner, also about the manuscript. Walter said he had heard something about the custodians, but he was not sure who they really were, or if it was a secret organization. The situation was not at all encouraging. Butler did not show up, and the plan without him seemed impossible to carry out. Besides the risk it seemed to entail against an unknown organization that was chasing us without even having left the port. We made the decision to postpone the trip again, until we could find Butler. We would try again to find him at his home the next day. As expected, we were unable to find Butler, and the chances of the trip were being destroyed by the minute, along with the concern of the captain's whereabouts. The team also communicated with other known people and members of the naval force. Nobody knew anything about him. It seemed as if he had been swallowed by the earth. November 14th arrived, with the plan already cancelled. But someone knocked on my door, and to my total surprise it was Captain Butler, with provisions, maps, and everything necessary to leave. He commented to me as if it was nothing, "It is time to leave, comrade." I asked him as many times as possible where he had gone, and I also had to explain to him the strange last 2 days that the whole team had spent. He looked at me very coldly and commented, "It was to be expected. I had to hide for security and priority to protect the documents needed for the plan. Especially this map." He unfolded the map on the table of my living room. The map was huge. There was land I had never seen before. Butler ordered me to assemble the team, and that we had to leave today. I asked him if he knew the custodians, and he told me that there was a lot he had to tell. The story is not the one we were told, William. The creators of the pyramids and another race, as they also call them custodians, have no interest in us crossing the South Pole. He told me that they found out about our travel plan via Fint, who had betrayed him, and that the trip had to be made today, or we would never be able to make it. He also commented that we would have plenty of time later to give me more details about all this. I hurried to gather the whole team. Once we were all together, we left the port of Charleston, and we had a few stops before reaching the frozen areas of the south. Chapter 3. We have crossed the walls. We set sail at last from Charleston Harbor. We would be reaching the cold Antarctic waters 140 to 150 days. The second night of leaving the last port straight to Antarctica, I was on deck, looking at the horizon and thinking about this adventure. Then Butler approached. "Already cold, comrade? You can't imagine what awaits you then," he told me. "So you've been there?" I asked again. "Where do you mean, in the southern waters?" "Yes, of course," Butler affirmed. "That story you were telling that night, was it about you?" "I was there, William. I saw that passage with my own eyes. That's why I am wanted." All doubt left my mind. The captain then gave me a clear vision about his past voyage. The lights went on in me and illuminated all curiosity. Then he told me, "Don't worry, William. You will see it too. You will see what I saw with my eyes, and you won't believe it either. And I'm not just talking about the passage. But I won't talk about it until we can get there." The captain closed the conversation at the best moment. I had so many questions, as the reader will have at this moment, and I assure you that they will be answered in due time. At 138 days, we were in the icy waters, and the sudden difference was abysmal. The storm that had been chasing us for 8 days was getting worse. The captain was calm, and that gave us some security. We crossed a huge mountain that we had as a reference, where warm and cold winds intermingled even under the snow. It is very difficult to describe this place. It is simply unique. We were now sailing parallel to a giant wall of ice that loomed. We calculated that it would be between 80 and 90 meters high, and in some places there were peaks of even more height, but it was impossible to see it. Near this giant mountain, blocks of ice fell like absorbent cotton. The weather was inhospitable. It did not give us any respite. The fight was daily against the waves and the wind. We decided then to approach again the enormous mount. The strange heat emanating from the melting ice all around gave the strange appearance that it did not fit, that it should not be there. But it even seemed to generate a different climate. We decided with the captain to skirt it as much as possible and investigate thoroughly the strange portion in front of the giant ice barriers. Butler shouted my name and called me on deck. A passage opened up behind, between the giant frozen walls. The happiness that enveloped us was unexplainable, but we knew that we would not be there for a long time. Butler did not hesitate for a second, and we were all stunned. The ship was heading that way. The captain seemed to know what he was doing and left the boat parallel to the promontory. And then a kind of current took us inside without even thinking twice. We were dragged by an enormous force. Fear paralyzed us. We brushed the edges of that wall several times. All this panic lasted 3 or 4 minutes. But inside us, it seemed to be eternal. Suddenly, at once we were sailing on this current that was dragging us, calm seemed to invade our surroundings. The storm ceased, and although the cold was still lashing, it was no longer overwhelming. We were in an ecstasy. This narrow passage was opening more and more, and gave way to an open sea. My eyes did not lie. I dabbed them through several times. The captain shouted, "We made it, we made it," and we all celebrated with surprise and amazement. We were in waters that only very few reached. Or so we thought at that moment, at least. The dark waters began to clear. The ice walls were still visible, but were being lost in the distance. The sun that contemplated our feet was falling on the horizon. It was time to boast. I gathered the team by decision of the captain, who called us all with some seriousness, and he was going to make an important announcement. He began by saying that what he was going to comment was not about him, nor about the team, nor about the known earth that we were leaving behind. It was about the whole of humanity and its past.